half coming up for 6 years in the summer as kind of like DP World. Started off recruitment, launched apprenticeship program. Now I'm responsible for the whole of the training function for operations through to park, through to the port, through to leadership. Prior to joining London Gateway, I literally was next door at Corriton Refinery. I was there for 8 years. The last 4 years of that was running the apprenticeship program, so I know some familiar faces from the old days as well as the new. I did think of going to do what I normally do, and that's talk about why we launched the apprenticeship program early at London Gateway, what it means to us, and I thought, no, because for those of you that have been here before, it's going to be old ground game. One of the things I have got scars from, and they are scars, is when we've had to say no to an apprentice at the end of their time for not having a job. So what I want to do is look at when you want an apprentice or when you think you're going to employ an apprentice, what's your thought process? Where do you start? So just quickly in the room, who has apprentices in the room? A couple. When you have this epiphany that we're going to have apprenticeship programs and we're going to have them here, where do you start? Do you start with what you're looking for now or what you need for the future?
What we're trying to do is analyse.
We've got it down to a fine art. We do what you do. We know there's a national shortage. There always has been for a long time. We're trying to plug it. Hence why we launched the engineering apprenticeship program before we even had a key. It was still sand. So we've got that part right. The part we haven't got right is in other areas. So we branched out in IT and business admin. And I'm going to share this because I don't want anyone else to have to go through telling the young person, you've done a fantastic job for 2 years. However, there isn't headcount for you. Because that is soul destroying not only for the young person, but also for the manager who's having to tell them. Now, I'm not naive enough to know that business demands dictate, but as managers, we need to be slicker at actually what the end goal is. So we launched IT and Business Admin, and at the time we genuinely thought there was a need. So we recruited two IT, and at that time two or four Business Admin. But two, if I'm honest, we kind of floated them in the FM area. So there was a job, but they could be either in reception or they could even be in the back office in FM. And that sounds, in an ideal world, perfect. You rotate them from front of house, you rotate them to the back of house, they get the whole picture. What we didn't look for properly was 2 years after, do we need another headcount on the front of house? Do we need another support staff member in the FM team? And we know business changes, because at the time when we recruited them, yes we did. 2 years down the road, we didn't. So I think for me, anyone going into apprenticeship programs, really think, what is our end goal? Can we, and you can't guarantee in this day and age, and I know that, but realistically, what is the likelihood of having a job? And if you're really not sure, then think very hard on what you are doing. Now, there's two schools of thoughts to that. One, we've still done a bloody good job to give four apprentices that we couldn't keep a foundation that they wouldn't have had otherwise. So from a personal perspective, on putting back into the local community, we've done good. And personally, I think for a young person to stay in the same job for boy to man like the old days, I don't know if that's always the best thing for young people. There is a huge world out there. Just look in Thurrock alone, look at the industries that we've got locally. We've got some big hitters that we can share. So for me, we did okay. But put yourself in that young person's position. What did I do wrong? But you're telling me that I did okay. So even though they may not get it now, they may get it later on down the line. One thing we try and do a lot is work with our third party providers, certainly if we find ourselves in that position, and also networking to say, look, we've got these people, we can't offer them a job. But the biggest thing I'm saying now to employers is think very hard. Always link in. If you don't think you can offer a full-time apprenticeship program, South Essex College, ProCat, other colleges are available, dare I say it, but for the local ones, link in. Potentially they're available for us. But link in with these guys, because, and I'm sure you will hear from them And I like what you've said, you're starting to use that as more of as a graduate kind of like forum. And I think with the levy, that's the way to go. Anyone in the room not pay the levy? So everyone's been hit by the levy in one way or another. How are you spending your money? Are you spending your money? Because when we talk about apprenticeship programs, what do we all think about? Young people? Do you think of upskilling your current staff? Have you been used?
As a grandmother, as a businesswoman, congratulations to each one of you. DP World and this industry, as we all know, has a shortage of women, but I'm very proud to say from DP World, we have two ladies sitting here, Sue Porter, our training manager, and myself. We need to see more women in executive roles. We need to see more women in the board meetings. How do we do it? We need to break the glass ceiling. Are we ready to do it? I think we as women need to support each other and break that glass ceiling. We want to see all these women in boardrooms and executive management positions. And I hope someday we can do that. Now going on to my presentation. I'm going to just talk a little bit about DP World as a company, and then the port, the park, and the rail in London Gateway. Introduction to DP World as a group, and then I'll go and talk a little bit about London Gateway, and then the port and the logistics park. DP World, a leading global enabler of trade and an integral part of the supply chain. This company is based in Dubai, UAE, the United Arab Emirates, and we first opened our terminal in Jebel Ali in 1979. After which we went international in the year 2000, and then in 2007, we listed in the Dubai Nasdaq. This has been a great success story for DP World. From then on, we started going international to 41 countries in the six continents, where we have today 78 container terminals, operations, and running and managed by DP World. In 2017, we did 70 million TEUs, and we have a very ambitious plan of being 100 million TEUs by the end of 2020. That's our vision, our strategy, and the road ahead for us. We have about 37,000 people working from 110 countries all over in our terminals. We have 70,000 vessels per year, and in any given day, we have 190 vessels in the ports. So that's how big we are. We are the third largest port operator in the world. Now as we go into London Gateway, a deep sea port, a logistics park, and a railway terminal. London Gateway has now been established and approved product because we opened in 2013. The whole terminal is built on 220 acres. We have three berths. Each berth has four superposed Panamax cranes, which can bring in the largest vessels that are in operation today, right up to the 22,000 TEUs. We have a 17-meter draft, so we can bring in three big 400-meter vessels and operate them in London Gateway. This terminal is semi-automated. One part of it is semi-automated, and the other part is completely automated. Why do we do this? We do this because of safety. We are focused on our people. One of our values are our people, and we want to keep them safe. Yes, productivity is important. Turning the ship around is important. Keeping costs down is important, but most important is the safety of our people. So we in DP World spend a lot of money on IT solutions. In some of our terminals, we have cranes that are remote control operated from a room sitting. I've just come from Turkey, where I built a $650 million project, a container terminal, where I put up six cranes. And I made sure it was remote control. For several reasons, the safety of the people, to see more ladies sitting and operating cranes because it's much easier and comfortable in a room. And ladies are much more disciplined, pardon gentlemen around. So DP World London Gateway, we have the land side is completely automated, where we have an algorithm that keeps the containers moving really fast, and the seaside is semi-automated with straddle carriers. Then we have the park, which is built on 460 acres, where we offer solutions to our tenants and occupiers to build warehouses and distribution centers. This is only leased land. It's not a freehold, it's just leased land to occupiers who want to come and build warehouses and solutions for the supply chain. We opened in 2000.
They don't really know how to spend their money. And when they're talking to providers, providers are probably confusing them even more because they're only talking to them about what they are able to deliver. There's been changing in apprenticeships. We now have a thing called standards. What is that? What's the difference between frameworks and standards? So ever more there is a confused state of employers out there that just don't know how to spend their levy, and they're not being supported by their providers that they're talking to enough and in a way that they're able to understand how they can get the best out of this money and actually how can they bring new talent into their business and how can they upskill the current people that they've got working for them. And that's really what I wanted to talk to you today about. Having an apprenticeship, having an apprentice, having an apprenticeship scheme just makes good business sense. If you're thinking about bringing new people into your business, it's about bringing new energy, it's about bringing new ideas. And I know somebody spoke about having a blank canvas. That's absolutely right. If you want to bring new talent in, you can train them into the ways that you require as your business to bring all of that energy and new ideas and new thinking into your business. You can develop everybody within your business so it meets your needs. And obviously industry is changing over time. The technical industries are changing even more so. And young people coming into that industry have got the ideas that we may not even be aware of. Actually having an apprentice is a very cost-effective way to bring new entrants into your business. Now what we don't want to talk about is it's cheap labour, it's free for you to bring people in. But actually, when you think about hiring somebody, it's a very, very expensive process. And if you choose the provider very carefully, they can actually work with you. And often they will provide a complimentary recruitment service that will support you in identifying the right talent that you require for your business. You can grow your team in a cost-effective way. I think you've all nearly got levy money available to you. I think the importance is identifying, as Sue alluded to it earlier, is what is it that you need? Work with the provider that you're talking to. Think about what your roadmap looks like. What do you need this year? What do you need next year? What do you need in the year after? And what frameworks, what standards are out there that will support you in enabling you to upskill your current workforce? And I'll go on to talk about some tips of what you can do to work with some of your employers. 96% of employers say that apprenticeships make good business sense. And that's talking with a wide range of SME employers and with large levy paying employers. And I don't think apprenticeships are going to go away. I think funding is going to become more available to us. I know Sue spoke about 16 to 24 and 19 plus funding, and I don't think that is going to change. I think the government are absolutely focused on supporting industry to upskill their workforce. So, my top tips. I was kind of thinking about what we should do and how we should inspire employers. So I got to thinking about what employers are talking to us about when they come to us. And often, things that they talk about is actually providers make it very hard to understand. Providers don't often bring the right information that you as an employer might need. They can be very confused in their messaging. They think they're giving you the right information, but actually what they're doing is probably complexizing some of the things. So choose your training provider wisely. Talk to, share with, with all of your networks. Understand who they are and what they are able to provide. And often you will find very, very good outstanding providers out there that are very local to your community. The provider that you work with should be able to support you. make sure when you're working with that provider that they are able to work with you collaboratively. If they don't, they're not the right provider for you. Then go on to find somebody that will give you that support. Because that's why we're here. That's why I've moved from working with I've been with a college for a very short space of time, but I've moved from private provider into college. Because the college often are very static. They would expect employers to come to them. Their students can be one-dimensional. That's not the way that they want to work. They need to be able to engage with you. So that's what we are trying to do at Southeast College.
Employer supported placing, which is what I'm here to talk to you about. Well, it's a national scheme owned by the Home Office. And I know there's a few people that have seen this presentation already that I'm doing, but I would imagine that most employers have heard of or take part in the defence recognition scheme, which is where you allow members of your staff who are reserve forces time off to do training or any other of the activities that they're required to do for their military skills. But prior to this event, I wonder how many of you have heard of ESP, the Employer Supported Policing Scheme? No, exactly. It's a government scheme. It's owned by the Home Office, but it seems to be one of those great government secrets. So, what is the scheme? So, the scheme really is similar to the defence scheme, where we ask you to allow your members of staff who are special constables time off in order to carry out their duties and do some duties as a special constable. Unlike the employer scheme, where I think they actually come to you and say, you've got Joe Bloggs who's in the Territorial Army, we need you to give him 10 days off a year. That's not what we do. Our scheme recognises that one size doesn't fit all. So our scheme is bespoke. So we come to you to look at what it is that you're able to give, the size of your company, the skills that the special constable may bring to your company, and how they can benefit from being a special constable, how that benefits yourself. And we look and we say to you, what is it that you can give to help us all out? And it's a partnership. And we generally do look at this as being a partnership. We'd like as well, depending on the size of the company, to look at recruiting. So maybe if you have an intranet system, posters, flyers, and that kind of thing. And again, it does depend on the size of your company. If we could come into your company and speak to your staff and recruit them if you don't have special constables already. So we start off with really, what is a special constable? Without going into egg-sucking territory, a lot of people do confuse special constables with PCSOs. But a special constable is effectively a part-time police officer, the same as the reserve forces. So they have exactly the same powers, wear exactly the same uniform, have exactly the same kit. The training's not quite the same, it's not as intensive as a regular officer, but they do have that legal training. And they are bound by police regulations and the code of ethics as well. So that they become part of the police family, and they are bound by all of those rules and regulations that have the impact on their private life as well. So we're asking you to give your staff paid time off to do policing duties. So there must be something in it for you. So we believe there are many benefits to employers. For instance, corporate social responsibility is high on the agenda, I think, for a lot of companies these days. And we think that ESP is a great vehicle to promote that, the community engagement there. Special constables are widely regarded by employers as being more committed, dependable, confident and responsible in the workforce. And as a special constable, your staff will develop many new skills, and I've deliberately put that one up there and just left that there when I'm talking so you can see that. training. I'm not saying that your own training doesn't develop these skills, but police training develops all of these skills.